the blood we've shed before. Did you ever stop this notice? This crying earth, this weeping shore.
Two weeks ago, there was a report of a massive oil spill in Bonny. Exactly the spot was where the Bonny Environment Consultants claimed that Shell personnel were carrying out an excavation job, and that it was the swamp boogie that Shell was using for the excavation that caused the accident that led to the massive oil spill. There have been conflicting reports over that. Shell claimed there was a third party sabotage. The community people said it was Shell. Shell claimed it was just 3,800 barrels of crude oil. Community people claimed it was about 30,000 barrels. Social Action stepped in to do their own investigation. And we are going to give you firsthand the video clip of the spill, of the work that Shell officials were carrying out of the Transnistria Delta pipeline, and statements from Professor Abere himself, the man, the Amayaba of Bonny, entrusted the Bonny Environment into his care as the chairman of PEC, Bonny Environment Consultant Committee. We'll give you all that and I will come back to you. Thank you.
I am Amma Senebo of Grand Bonny Kingdom. That's to say title citizen of the kingdom. My name is Sudienye Abere and I am the chairman of Bonny Environment Consultant Committee. The Environment Consultant Committee, normally called BEC, is a functional arm of the kingdom put together by His Majesty and the Bonny chiefs and peoples to act as a watchdog over the kingdom concerning environment matters. The BEC has been in operation since 1997 and has the mandate of the kingdom to solicit on its behalf. We carry out studies, tests, and engagements with proponents and multinationals that are prospecting in our kingdom. I am a professional and a lecturer. Talking about the most recent, which is that of the 22nd November 2014, the information came to me from one of my pollution officers in Bonny on the 23rd. But before then, we had had to, a week earlier, we had had to go on the site monitoring visit, because there have been several SPDC activities, renovation, we might call whatever routine operations around and about the Oloma axis, the Okolo launch, Shobiekiri, and what they call the Bonny flow station axis. Some pipelines have been replaced, certain ruptured pipes were being clamped and all that. Our attention, actually, we are not called to this by SPDC. They just went into action. That was what necessitated our going to have that kind of survey. When we got there, actually they were working with swamp boogie and all other kind of machinery that, well, you can also look at. There was no case of spillage. So it was with mixed feeling when my operative called after about 5 days of the visit, 5-6 days of the visit, that there had been a massive oil spill in the areas that we just visited. And it was like a surprise to me because we just took a speedboat around the place and all that, and we only saw the area that was being worked upon. That is the what we call the Otokolomabi area. It happens that it is this same area that the spill came off from, and it is very obvious that one of the equipment working for SPDC at that site caused one of the pipelines to rupture. I might not be using the appropriate terms, but there was an extensive damage to the pipeline, the 24-inch pipeline that carries the Bonny light. The result of that is massive oil spill emptying into the mud flats and into Bonny rivers and creeklets. It became necessary to go back on site. Volcanic eruption, in this case of crude oil, and how they gush into the waterways at such a speed that I might not be a decent estimator, but no less than 30,000 barrels must have escaped from that line. The reason being that when it was first struck, nobody took attention. From the 21st to the 22nd and to the 23rd, nobody took attention of it. Some thought it was, some of the workers, shell workers there on site thought it was an abandoned line. Some thought that what was coming was, according to them, initially water, so it must have been a vacated line. But over the period, it became so clear that it is crude. From the video clip, it is so clear also, because the clips were taken at ebb tide, when there is supposed to be no water in those creeklets and rivulets. But all that you can see there is oil, high enough or deep enough for a speedboat to run on it. We remained there, or the observers at the time remained there until flow tide, and were able now to move following the direction of flow of crude.
Has anything been damaged as a result of this spill?
That is a very, very, I don't want to be indecent, it's a very, very wrong question to ask. When there is spillage in an environment as fragile as the mangrove and the flood, I mean the mud flats of Bonny, the damages that result are inexplicable, because the crude is not only on water, it's on the mud flats, it's on the vegetation, it's even in the air. Those traveling from Port Harcourt and other places will be first greeted by the stench of hydrocarbon fugitive emissions before looking around to see that the whole water is also filled up with floating hydrocarbon. So fishing gears, vessels, the boats that the people use for their fishing, and the traps, normally the type of fishing that we do, we cast net and we set traps, and then we go out with other gears, hooks and all that to make our daily living. You cannot go a fishing anymore. You will be fishing on crude. Yes, we were able to capture a fisher folk, you know, who was caught up by the flow of the cruise while fishing ordinarily. So crabs, all the crustaceans, and all the bottom feeders have been impacted. The women normally engage in picking periwinkles, oysters, and clams and things like that during ebb time. The men go out for cast net fishing, artisanal fishing kind of. But as we speak, nobody dares move out. And the worst scenario is the fact that the Bonny Island is crisscrossed by several rivers, rivulets, creeks, and such. So it becomes really, really difficult for there to be any space around the Bonny Kingdom right now where you can think of fishing or such activities going on. Reason being that ours is a tidal setting, flow tide and ebb tide. And all this tide will carry these hydrocarbons, you know, they float until they begin to weather or crack before they will now sink and go to the bottom. So even the commuters, those who use speedboats to do transport business, are also impacted seriously. Any drop of water, seemingly looking like a drop of water on the clothes of the passengers, it becomes an economic important situation, because the clothes will now be stained with crude. And all of us know that crude has the ability to go into vapor, has the ability to expand, and it has an irritating sensation on the skin when touched. And especially when there is sun, it burns as if in hot water. So I am very convinced that social action is the port of call, because we are aware of their activities in Ogoliland, in Umuchim, and in other communities where they have had to escalate or push forward their matters. We want the whole world to know what has happened to the Bonny people, and that the livelihood of the people had been impacted. And this is a festive period when everybody comes home, those in diaspora, those in Abuja, Lagos, and far parts of the country will come home this December period. And what are they going to meet? They will not have water to drink, because ours is a shallow well water system. All the well waters will now be infested with crude. They will not even be able to go and swim, take a dip as we normally do in the creeks anymore, because they are all cluttered with fuel, with crude, and with all sorts of damaging things. They cannot even have a good breath, because Bonny in those days, we do not need, before these various activities, we didn't need air conditioning for our buildings. The fresh breeze coming in from the tidal inundations of the Bonny River was enough to cool us, was enough to refresh us. We want you, the social action, to please call on the proponents, SPDC, NNPC also, because this is Nigeria, and the all other right activists of the world, to bring pressure to bear on SPDC to come and clear the mess very quickly and put up mediative action, and of course see to the adequate compensation for the people. Indeed, there have been multiple spills, and we use this opportunity to call for an environmental audit of the Bonny areas. You see that over about 10 kilometers of riding, okay, using a 150 horsepower engine to move from the spill site, you can move for 55 minutes without going to the end of where this oil has reached, which means our western part, that is Kalibia, Makuruma, Peter Zaid, and the Cotton Channel areas have been affected. The parts of Ogoni land, which are the north above Opopo Channel, our northern boundaries, have been affected. Other parts to our east, the Andonis, over the Andoni River, have also been affected. So, much as we are talking about ourselves, we also talk for our sister communities who have been affected by this one spill. I have never seen anything like this in my life. I started lecturing in 1989, so I'm about 25 years in this business. Have turned out several graduates. And of course, I'm a professional. I've consulted for many companies and bodies. I have never seen this magnitude. There was a spill of 2007, the Abrabia spill. It was an onshore spill. Impacted several hectares, but it is nothing to be compared with this. This must be over 5 or 8 thousand hectares. This must be over that, because the we estimate the spill crude to be over 30,000 barrels, and all on surface waters. It's terrible. So I request of social action to assist us to put across these demands for the kingdom of Bonny, for the kingdom of Bonny. First of all, there is a purported joint inspection visit where no Bonny man, no Bonny community person was represented. That document was not signed by any Bonny representative. If there be anybody to sign at all, it is on behalf of King or the Bonny Kingdom, it is Beck, either myself or any person designated by me. So we are calling on them to have a repeat of the JIV where we'll be properly represented. Secondly, we would require them to come into a cleanup as fast as possible. We are not here to lower standards or to attack this matter with kid gloves, because the whole area in Bonny is messed up. Therefore, we want to know the methodology they will use in the cleanup. We want to be part of the assessment of damages done with them, not whatever they come to tell us as they normally do. Thirdly, the remediation should follow immediately, and a monitoring of this thing must be done both by international and local consultants. The reason being that we don't want standards to be compromised in any form. We also demand that the whole area be audited. We are part of even the Bodo incidents, because there is no way you go to Bodo or Bubolo without reaching Bonny anyway. because our waters crisscross there, and our communities are also around those areas. So we must have the same standard as the Buddha, whatever they are having in Ogoni land concerning this audit. And it is necessary for that audit to be done as quickly as possible. Compensation, yes. There must be compensation. I have put compensation last to tell the whole world that we are not interested in money, but we are interested in our place being habitable. But then, we will fold our hands while we are cleaning up, while we are pursuing the case. We must, the people must eat something. Therefore, adequate compensation must be arranged and made available in the soonest time to the Bonny people.
As you can see from the video and the intervention there by Professor Berry, the spill that happened in Bonny was a very massive one. Being an organization and a group of people that have worked all our life in the Niger Delta here, we have seen more spill. But Professor Berry said that that was the worst he has ever seen all his life. According to him, he said he has never seen anything like this before. But Social Action has worked in Ogoni, we have worked in Rumwekwe, and then we have seen some major spills that are far worse than what Professor Berry. I said, but I have some questions for Shell here. How come that the Trans-Niger Delta pipeline was not isolated when this excavation was going on? How come that they did not put off the pipeline before carrying out any activity at all? And this further shows how she treats the people and the environment another better. Because you cannot leave a generator on and start commence servicing of a generating plant. You must put it off. And I'm sure that because all she thinks about the profit, money, they were thinking about the number of vessels that were at the terminal waiting to be loaded. And so loading can go on while the excavation work or this kind of thing can go on. And I think that's wrong. As you can also see from the video, fishermen were right there, and we have the privilege of meeting with them. Their fishing gear and equipment were soaked with crude oil. Buttressing the point that possibly a better raised, that the entire livelihood of Bonny people have been destroyed. That's true. And if Shell is denying that they were not responsible for what happened, how come that Shell hurriedly sending relief material? I know Shell to be very stingy. They have claimed separately that they are not a charitable organization. How come that they only sending relief material to those in Antony, to those in Bonny? How come that they send their consultants to urgently, you know, commence cleaning up? As I speak, their consultant is already in Antony, carrying out that job. If Bonny people conclude discussion with them, because throughout last week they were talking, if Bonny conclude discussion with them, I know that the contractor will also move into Bonny. So there are several questions on how Shell treated the Niger Delta environment and people with so much neglect. I think that this is not the first time that this is happening. One thing I would also like to know is who was the officer in charge of that excavation work, and what is Shell's work safety procedure? Because I don't think that any sane man will allow that kind of job to be carried out on a lifeline. And I think that in support of what Professor Berry has said, Social Action will be calling on the international community, civil society groups everywhere, to call upon Shell to respect international best practice. Because what they are doing in this country, they will not do elsewhere. if their equipment is not failing and spilling oil to destroy our God-given environment, they are calling in the military or the police to kill innocent people, such as they did in Omochen, where social trials also working. They did that in Rumwekwe. The entire community now has been sacked. They did that in Ogoni. Social action, fortunately, is working in these three communities. And we've seen quite a lot from them. And they will continue to do this. I'm sure that they are on an assignment to either exterminate everybody in the Niger Delta and destroy the environment, or turn it into an oil field completely. And that is unacceptable. And so we'll be calling on Shell immediately to withdraw the JMB report that they have posted on their website. Because Professor Abel is the only man authorized to supervise or be part of any discussion, if any, you know, concerning and related to the Bonny environment or people delegated by him. In this case, Shell has exposed one of the areas they have been cheating and telling lies to the world. Because this kind of thing they've been doing. They will just write anything in the JRB report and call any person on the street, give them B not to sign on behalf of the people that were supposed to do it. If Professor Berry did not come to social action for us to come into this matter, and we were able to secretly video everything that happened, Shell would have denied. They would have said, "Come in, people sign. You have heard on tape where the prof himself has said that he is not aware, nobody in his committee is aware of any JIB. They have to pull down that JIB immediately. They have to commence immediate cleanup of that environment." And like the prof said, I think that they need to also do another audit after the government. This is the UN report on government. Think that they have to do another audit in the Niger Delta, and this time it will be in Bonny, because quite a lot of spill has happened in Bonny, and that is unacceptable. We will not continue, you know, to allow Shell to pollute our environment. Pipelines that Shell is using to transport crude all over the Niger Delta were laid 5 decades ago. They have outlived their usefulness and their lifespan. They are spilling oil every day. They are rusty now. They are failing every day. The wellheads are failing every day. And because of their profit-minded mind, they are not carrying out routine checks. As I went to you, everything about them is money, money, money. And people are dying. I think it is high time that Shell has to change. Otherwise, I think the Niger Delta people have to urgently mobilize and send them out completely, whether offshore or onshore. There is no game telling us that they are selling their facilities onshore and they are hiding. We change them anywhere they are, because we have nothing that we can point at to say this is the benefit from having oil. After 5 decades, this is unacceptable. And social action will not stop in pursuing this matter until justice is done. Thank you.
What about sunrise? What about rain? What about all the things that you said we were to gain? What about killing fields? Is there a time? What about all the things that you said was yours and mine? Did you ever stop to notice all the blood we shed before? Did you ever stop to notice this crying earth, this weeping shore?